care work, we're in a domiciliary setting or a residential nursing home, are rooted into something within the NHS. And I think that's why we have to start thinking about growing our own, giving people the opportunity for on-the-job support and training and development. And really to actually make it to be an exciting place, but also not to recruit for what we have, but to recruit for what we need for the future. So looking at, so for example, a programme I've been sponsoring is the development of advanced paediatric nurse practitioners across Cheshire and Merseyside. I think we have 5 or 6 working on Wirral. And that's because we actually need them to do more in-depth work with young children and families to keep them out of hospital settings and do more community settings. We need, as Karen said, to redesign the workforce of what we're going to need rather than what we've had. And what we've had traditionally has been a very hospital-centric model. What we're trying to turn around is to be a more health and wellbeing community-centric model.
Well, okay, that was a pretty good try. That's a rhetorical question. The main fact is, if you could pay them more, you could keep them, couldn't you?
Chair, could I also add in that clinical aspect that we have to bear in mind that over that time, there's also been a very significant increase in need for these services because of the increasing elderly population. And whilst we're living longer, we are not living healthier. So the years of ill health have increased, and hence need for nursing care and increasing different skills amongst our nursing colleagues has increased significantly over that time.
Can I just address the issue of pay, because it might be helpful. It's not necessarily always about pay. NHS staff are paid on a pay spine. Most of them are on a national pay spine. So, and we try to enhance that pay spine for additional qualifications. So if you train more, if you have more qualifications, we can enhance that pay. But we're quite restricted in terms of the pay we can offer. So please don't think that there's somebody in Manchester waving pound notes in the air, because they're not. But they can sometimes, in inner cities, they can put a premium on something because they have the money to do that, because they have a bigger pool to recruit to, therefore they have a bigger budget. However, some of the complexities around workforce recruitment and retention are not about money. They're about a lot of our clinicians choose to work nearer and with university establishments. They choose to work in the city because they have a different breadth and depth of career advancement. And we are actually always fighting this, always. And sometimes we're really lucky because people choose to work in somewhere that doesn't have those things to offer, because we build relationships with the likes of Liverpool University, Chester University, and others. But we have to go out of our way to build those relationships, which is why Cheshire and Merseyside is coming together to look at some of the workforce issues together. It's not always about pay. It's about lifestyle, work-life balance, all of those issues. And we've got a lot of things to consider to modernise this workforce and retain this workforce of the future. Furthermore, like every other part of the public sector, and I'm sure you've heard this from other people, we also have a workforce that is ageing. And coupled with the challenges of bringing new, young, fresh things into the system, new, fresh people, who sometimes don't want to because of the university challenges, the cost challenges, that's a real challenge for us. You know, in the next 5 to 10 years, we have an ageing workforce, and we've got to address not only how we train the staff we've got to meet some of those gaps, but also how we deal with a number of those people leaving at the same time.
So we've reduced it to supply and demand. If you had more, they wouldn't all go to Manchester because some of them would still be here.
I think you're being provocative purposely, but I take your point. I think the issue is complex and it's multifaceted, but we know what the issues are, and we are working hard for Will on all of those fronts.
Can I just move this along, because I think we've done this bit to death. If I can just bring in Jackie, and then we have Councillor Lewis. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. It's a really quick point, moving on all the things that have been said from the group. I think we know the challenges we've got. Councillor Gilchrist referred earlier on to our transformational plan that we're working on, which we've had for several months. We know the challenges of the workforce, and actually the best one in the world, there isn't the workforce out there for the growing demand. We've got to get into some sustainable transformational change and look at different models and approaches. And that plan includes looking at integrated therapy offers, it's building on the integration of health and social care, stripping out energy duplication and really maximising our approach to the staff that we've got, and looking at technology and what technology can do to actually having a different approach and being able to get more bang for our work group.
Thank you, councillors.
Thanks, Chair. I'd make an observation, well, two observations to begin with, and two specific points for Mr. Banks and Ms. Howell, please. Firstly, I fully agree with Councillor Stewart. I think, you know, we're well aware of the acoustics in this building. Not to have proper acoustics for an issue as important as this, I'm not sure whether the audience can hear everybody and everything that's being said. I think it's important that we make the point again that we get the acoustics right in the building. It can't be beyond us to provide some microphones for our end of the table. Secondly, on the point that Ms. Howell made, myself and some colleagues visited Clatterbridge a few weeks ago, and the point was made there that they were very aware at Clatterbridge that they are very good at attracting staff because of the working environment and the positive working environment and staff there, and that is, you know, renowned throughout the UK. And there was also a concern that the new Royal Liverpool, obviously a significant investment in the NHS Liverpool, that has also been attracted staff there because of the working environment there. I'm interested to know specifically, by Ms. Howe and Mr. Banks can answer, in the summer, I think it was Wirral received an extra £1 million to assist with the winter pressures at A&E. And Mr. Banks has made reference to the recent budget where there was an extra amount that was to be allocated on top of that. Can Mr. Banks and Ms. Howe please advise, are they aware of how that £1 million has been spent or been committed that was made in the summer? And if there's an indicative amount from the recent budget for A&E in Wirral, and if they have any idea how that will be spent on the service, please.
We will find, in terms of the indicative amount from the recent budget announcement, we will find out on Thursday. And we've got a call with NHS England and NHS Improvement on Thursday morning at 9:30 that Jackie, myself, Val and David Allison as chair of the A&E Delivery Board will be on. The additional monies have been spent upon what's in the A&E Delivery Plan, which is the improvement of domiciliary care, which is the step-up beds, step-down beds at Clatterbridge. It's the therapy services, admission avoidance service, etc., better care fund services, etc.
Just so we're clear, Chair, so that the £1 million that was announced in the summer, that is to relieve pressures on domiciliary care?
It's
for animals, is that what you're saying?
No, it's a range of packages which are included in the 9-point delivery plan for urgent care. So it's, you don't just focus on one part of the system, we have to look at all parts of the system, both in terms of avoiding people needing A&E, what happens when people are in the hospital itself in terms of improving flow and getting people out quickly and appropriately to in supported settings. So, for example, working on discharge to assess work.
Okay, thank you.
Chair, can I just... Ian said the Clatterbridge is good at retaining staff. The oncology units are 9 consultants now, and it's a small unit.
Mike, if we can just move
9 consultants now.
Okay, we now take on agenda items. Urgent care transformation, which is item 5, and again, Simon, that's over to you, I'm afraid.
Okay, the slight amendment.
Sorry, Rob, but I've actually missed on the Eastern Walk-in Centre. I have actually missed some recommendations that the adult care plan be through screen security, that's the contents of the report, and that the committee are asked to make the formal request made by the CCG to the Community Trust to submit a plan. By the 17th of November, which was done, and we actually got that in fact on the 15th of November.
Sorry, Jake, I may be wrong, but if I had a machine, there was a thing that we're asking to know the impact.
Yes, yes, thank you. Take the vote on this. Yes, please.
And that's agreed, Chair. That's agreed.
Yes, Councillor Allen.
Agreed.
Thank you. Okay, so we've had that again now, we'll call it on to the aged care, and again, that's you, Sam.
Okay, a point was made during the last discussion about not undertaking transformation activity whilst in the middle of winter. So there has been a change to the timetable that's been presented to you today about the urgent care review, and I'll come on to that shortly. So we have been mandated by NHS England to implement a new model of urgent and emergency care services in December 2019. There are a number of people working on this. Dr. Helen Downs is our clinical lead for the CCG, and Jackie Evans works across the CCG and the local authority in terms of some of the supporting intended management capacity. Obviously, also we work alongside the Community Trust and alongside David Allison, both in his capacity of Chief Executive of the Hospital Trust as Chair of the AIM Delivery Board. So in terms of the must-dos, we have to have by December 2019 an urgent treatment centre for our system. Also, sooner than that, we have to look at our mandated got-to-haves for primary care. So primary care, in terms of the core offer of the 51 practices that we currently have across Wirral, already treat and see most of the urgent care needs of our population. They will have same day and planned access appointments. So that's a core offer we would have to have. But in addition to that, we have to have GP out of hours cover, which the Community Trust currently provides. And also we're having to make sure that GPs offer extended access to planned and same-day appointments, 8 to 8, 7 days a week for the Wirral. We recognise, having done the best part of 18 months, 2 years work on this in terms of value stream analysis, that there is not a consistent clear offer around urgent and emergency care on Wirral. And we have proposed to go out for formal consultation on this model yesterday. However, having taken advice from NHS England and also taken advice from elected representatives in the room, from the chair of scrutiny, from the Leads for Health and Wellbeing for the council, and for Councillor McLaughlin, we believe that actually needs to do a lot more pre-consultation work on this and spend some time with you, perhaps in depth. We've had the opportunity to brief you at an evening meeting recently about the nature and the structure of the NHS. But to do some more work with you about making these proposals understandable to the public, because at the moment they're very much presented in NHS speak. To pull out a little bit more about what the additional provision in the middle looks like, to understand the needs of the local population, to do some more work about transport links, costings and so on. So actually to go out in the summer now, rather than in January, or indeed November today, the initial proposal was January to move to. Actually, I think it would be better if we did a real good 6 months' work with local people on pre-consultation around what this might actually mean. So actually we come at it with a real open discussion about what's clinically, what's the clinical best model, but also what's affordable. I don't know if Jackie or Helen want to add anything to that.
The only thing I would add is that while Simon's referenced that proposals are given money to delay going out live to consultation, is that whilst we appreciate the timescales for the mandated elements like the urgent treatment centre and having that at Arrow Park site, then what we don't want to do is lose too much traction of time, so we would look to having couple of working groups looking at the estates and the physical development to get a really robust, efficient urgent treatment centre in place within the time scale. And the second element would be to look at the most efficient staffing model. So we would still propose to start the work on those things and obviously engage and stakeholders in sort of a task and finish type approach.
Okay, I'm going to start taking questions.
It's not a question, it's a comment. And the first thing I'd like to do is thank you for responding the way you have to the discussions that Councillor McMillan and myself had with you the other day. Firstly, about the language that you're using and the need to, I'm going to be quite careful myself about the language too, but regain credibility. Mm-hmm. And our suspicions would always be if we can't understand a report, then we are not going to really want to act on any recommendations that come out of that. And these reports are not easily understood. Mm-hmm. In fact, but thank you for taking it back and having a rethink about how best the consultation can be carried out, how we can link in with other services. We did talk about linking in whatever design and service you're doing around the needs of the local community and the transport links and other services that are available. And I look forward to seeing how that consultation pans out now. But thank you for taking on board the comments that we made today.
So as I said, this is a genuine offer to members of the scrutiny panel and to other people who are interested to help us shape what the response might be. So actually when we therefore go out, people are aware of what we're going to have to consult upon. They're also aware of what the cost envelope we're working within, what the best clinical models are, and how it would work for local people, and in a way that actually people can understand. That's a genuine offer from us. To the members of the panel. So it wasn't my place to pull the paper, Councillor McManus, that's yours as chair. And I think what we decided was to go ahead with the paper so you know what we're thinking, albeit in a way that sort of needs a bit more iteration and pulling out. But then to work with you over the period through till the consultation in June on actually probably in more depth in a different scenario to this and actually work through it in some detail. And so you have a greater understanding of what we're going to have to consult upon, but also you're informing what we're consulting upon.
Thank you, Simon. And I'd reiterate what Laura's already said, but I do appreciate that you've brought back that consultation so that it can be consulting. Councillor Sullivan, did you have a question?
Yes, Chair. I'd like to draw the committee's attention to the second paragraph. I won't read it all out in its entirety, but the first line of the second paragraph, the vision for urgent care is simple. Well, it is quite simple. You talked, Simon, about GPs working 7 days a week. Can I say again that there's a dearth of GPs and GPs, and I can't just pull them off shelves and take 6-7 years to train a GP. And you'd also talked about you're going to try and deliver what's affordable. I think that was key to everything you said there. And funding. I think what's holding this whole conversation and the first item on the agenda is funding. And it's a real lack of funding. You talked before, Sue, about an ageing population. Well, that ageing population, people like me, I'm at the younger end, I would think, of the ageing population. But we've paid our national insurance and our taxes. I'm still paying as it happens, even though I am retired. And we've paid for our services. We've more than paid for it. You know, I left school at 15. And I've worked right through, and I'm still working today.
So,
I'll finish now. But the real elephant in the room is lack of funding for every branch of the NHS. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. I think Dr. Sue
Wells
wants
to talk about that. So a couple of comments about GPs, because Helen and I are GPs. Yes, of course, we know that there's a national issue about the number of GPs, and there's an attempt to increase recruitment, but we know that's proving difficult. We do have to be very careful how we implement this. So I said to Simon, it is absolutely true, in the CCG role we are policy implementers. So there are policies that come that we need to implement. Now, that's what we're talking about, is mandated sections. And a mandated section is nationally that we move to 8 to 8, 7 days a week for extended general practice. Now, of course, the practical issue is that cannot be every GP, every practice, because, you know, whilst we might like to be able to be the Hermione time turner, we're not. So this proposal will not be about, we cannot implement it in every practice. We will have to work to make it an appropriate offer, a spread in a sensible way, so that it's in area, each area can access some. And we are working with GPs in how that could be implemented in a sensible fashion. In terms of funding, I'm afraid I go back to my pragmatic aspect that my role, I'm oiled as his role from CCG, is to make sure that we provide the best quality care for the residents of Wirral within our allocated allowance. And that's what my job is.
Thank you. Chris, thank you. Thank you, Chair. It'd be helpful when we do have the discussion to know what an urgent care centre actually looks like. Mm-hmm. I have no involvement with this, and with Governor CWP, but I know that one has opened on the Countess of Chester site, and there is a video of its interior on the CWP website. So I can see a series of suite of rooms, because it's filled at the times and there were no or staff present really apart from one or two. So I'm trying to form a picture. Second thing is back to money, I'm afraid. In the document that came out in spring, which had about 9 chapters, the end of chapter 7, I think, is on funding, has this sort of start paragraph. We know the pressures in the rural system. And there was also criticism in that document about some parts of the country overspending at the expense of others. The rules tried to balance things. So in that it said, going into 2017-18, it is critical that those geographies that are significantly out of balance now confront the difficult choices they have to take. Where necessary, this may mean explicitly scaling back spending on locally unaffordable services, going to the next 2 years with a viable and balanced income expenditure plan, delivering locally the government's mandate requirement for the NHS to balance its books. So a fairly lengthy quote, so that gives me the context that we're all trying to work within. Mm-hmm. So being realistic about what is going to emerge from this process, and then seeing whether that's good enough, and then saying whether it's good enough at the right time seems to be crucial for us.
In terms of urgent treatment centres, there's a nationally mandated, I'll speak of it. In terms of urgent treatment centres, there's a nationally mandated specification about what they need to look like. When I was in Holton, we managed, because we had a bit of resource in terms of capital and revenue at the time, we established 2 urgent care centres, one on the Wigness site and one on the Runcorn site, which, as Jackie said, has offered by writer to me if you wanted to visit Holton, I'm sure we could set up a members' visit to Holton to have a look around those 2 centres. And different areas are approaching the issue of GP extended access in remarkably similar ways. So recognising that you can't grow GPs on trees and you need to do primary care at scale. But equally, those people providing extended access can also be supporting the system, not just in those planned extended access, but supporting when people need an urgent or emergency appointment. And that's how we're trying to tackle it. Rather than what could appear to be 3 different policy streams, what we're trying to do is, as Councillor Gilchrist said earlier, dance with the chaos a bit and recognise that there are 3 different policy streams here, but try and bring them together as one, because there is only one rural pound, there's only one set of workforce that we need. There are only 51 practices who we want to start to work better at scale together. And that's really our challenge as policy implementers. But the more we can do, take this piece of work forward with you and have that public openness debate about what we have to have in place in terms of mandated extended primary care and mandated A&E stroke urgent treatment centres, I think the better, because we do need to have those conversations.
Thank you, sir. Can I move then to the recommendations? The committee for us to make the consultation of the report, but also that we recognise that the will and the consultation will be pushed back until June.
6, place-based care arrangements.
So, I'm afraid it's me again.
I will
hand over the IAP report to Joe in a moment, but when we get on to it. But place-based care arrangements, paper myself and Graham have prepared, and it really links into the quote that Councillor Gilchrist made there about systems having to look at working within the available resources and the automation within those resources, and looking about how you use them, as Dr. Wells said, for the best possible quality of care and health outcomes for a defined population. So this is about getting away from the purchase and provider split, and actually about commissioners of the service working really closely with providers about looking for solutions that deliver better health, better care and better value. And importantly for us, deliver the healthy rural agenda, because our place is rural. So there is a proposal that is currently going through, I think, Cabinet and also coming to the CCG government body about the development and delivery of a single integrated health and care commission for rural through a formalised partnership between the CCG and Rural Council. There's also work that Karen is currently sharing in terms of a rural partners, provider partners group, who's looking at what the potential provider response to that is. Because we want providers to work more in a collaborative way, a more integrated way to develop, again, a rural offer. Because the more we go out in terms of things like procurement, and the more we spend rural money outside of rural, the less of that's being retained within our current providers. And we actually really want providers in rural in partnership, not just traditional NHS providers, but not-for-profit sector providers and partners to be our most capable provision. So it avoids the need to use procurement, which costs money and doesn't always necessarily deliver us the best results. So we have a proposed approach that starts with the footprint of the one rural population, recognises the four hubs of the constituencies, and then moves into the 8 to 9 localities of between 30 and 50,000 people each, which then means you can start to deliver much more locally focused services. And that in itself recognises the lists of the general practices. Now we also recognise there's a place beyond rural. And in some circumstances, particularly around, let's say, orthopaedic services provided by the Hospital Trust, around inpatient mental health services that Cheshire and Rural Partners provide, or their learning disability services, we have to have a strong rural-orientated conversation alongside people in West Cheshire, so alongside our partners in Cheshire West and Chester Council, alongside the CCG there, but then on a wider footprint with other clinical commissioning groups and councils across the patch, particularly when you're talking about specialist or specialised services. So the paper really sets out the key features, the drivers of change of why we're moving to place-based care, growing demand, scarce resources, the need to move away from 30 to 40 years of actually working in a competitive environment to working more collaboratively, to recognising that a place is about where people live and people work and the community they orientate themselves to, the need for us as health and care leaders to step up and recognise that and work more collaboratively. It also gives you a bit of an outline about where we want place-based commissioning, also in terms of place-based provision. And as I said, the providers are responding very positively to that and come together around a number of areas, particularly the paper actually going to have next on improving access to psychological therapies. There's some really positive conversations going on across the not-for-profit sector with the NHS around how they wish to respond to that going forward. So I'm happy to take any questions on this as it stands. And again, happy to bring anything back to you in future as this develops as well. Again, on the basis of keeping the committee informed of key parts in the development of place-based care.
Okay, thank you, Simon. I'm also
going to
give you a great question on this.
I feel obliged to respond to Simon's other note. So
This is really important because it represents full membership in terms of how we work across Wirral with the broader system. Healthy Wirral is mentioned in the paper. That is our plan. We've got a clear, durable plan to increase this kind of vitality in Wirral. The place-based elements that we're talking about here are very much focused on Wirral as a place. So conversations about STP, about transport care, have all been about a plan that comes in from the NHS and is kind of imposed on Wirral. In essence, what we're saying is that Wirral is our plan. 80% of work will take place on Wirral. So we know that there are lots of things that we need to do on a Wirral basis. And as Simon said, there are instances where we need to work on a broader footprint. But that'll be where it makes sense to Wirral. So quite important this in terms of setting the context of how we work with the board of managers as well.
Thank you, Graham. I think there will be a number of questions. Can I just jump in first though and ask, similar to what you mentioned before, this paper is, it's NHS speak. I think it's called jargon. I have no idea. I'm not stupid. What horizontal and vertical means so can we ask, please, a recommendation from probably a few of us that if these things that use a plain English campaign, so that we actually, because like Moira, I get very, maybe it's my mind, I become more suspicious if I can't understand something. Thank you. And then we have a number of questions. We have Councillor Muspratt, I'll take Councillor Rennie, and then Councillor Sutherland, please. Thank you.
On page 33, because the language is a little different than we're probably used to, which is probably our fault of decision, we might probably find our paperwork more difficult.
Christine, if you put your microphone on, yes.
Sorry. On 325, it says place-based care has to deliver within a fixed financial envelope. Mm-hmm. Does that mean it's fixed for the year? So if you, if demand exceeds what you've got, then you go without towards the end of the year. And are all these recommendations, I mean, having worked in the health service, it is heartening that people are now speaking to each other. Last year, I remember many years ago, a sitting in St Catherine's trying to get this sort of thing done in mental health and getting better. But is this one finance driven, or is it driven because it's a good idea? And I would like,
I'd like to respond to that. Obviously, like, you've worked in the health service, and, it certainly said to me that the health service was twin separated at birth because of the primary, secondary, right from the start separation. And indeed, we all know it's fragmented a huge amount since then. And to me, this is the most important thing in my career that I've seen as a development, because what this does is say that what we need to do is put the person at the centre and concentrate on what people need. In this case, in areas, we know that we've always got huge different demographic differences, so we need to concentrate on the needs of the people, not the needs of organisations. So the organisations work together and stop what you referred to, and I completely have lived through for my time in the NHS, fragmentation, which is totally unhelpful. So the excitement to me on an NHS level is that we're working together. The huge increase of excitement that has come more recently is the way that we're working with social care. So to me, this is the most important thing I've seen in my career.
It explains the second part, but it doesn't tell me what fixed financial envelopes are.
The issue is that when we look at our health and care budgets together, about £640 million worth of resource comes into Wirral, and in dialogue with providers such as Karen's organisation and others, it's about how do we spend that more effectively and how do we ensure that more of that goes on patient care as well. So it's about looking at where we can make efficiencies within how we deliver services. So I think we've seen a really good example of that in terms of the decision to move social care provision into the community trust. So that starts to reduce the number of handoffs so that the individual sees one worker rather than three or four. And they get more continuity of care. You're able to intervene earlier. And the more you can do that, the more you can keep people out of hospital settings, which are the places that cost us money. But also they cost us in terms of the dependence it creates, because somebody sitting in a hospital bed will have muscle wastage, etc., etc. If we can ambulate them, keep them in their own homes, we can keep them active, the longer term cost of care is reduced, and more importantly, their experiences are improved. So that's where this is coming from. It's about, there is a fixed financial envelope. We do need to be more smart about how we commission services, so we know there are health inequalities in the borough, and we need to actually almost be targeting resources where we need to improve people's experiences of health and care. And we need to, what we call, I'm going back to the point you started with, if this is incomprehensible to you as somebody who's worked in the NHS, you said my view is it isn't your fault if you don't understand. It's our fault for not making it clear. I think that's the point I'm trying to make.
I think I'm saying that we all use jargon.
Yes.
Continue, because I'm just waiting to know what a fixed financial envelope is.
A fixed financial envelope is that £640 million we get to help them with.
Right. So the question I asked you was, does that mean that if you use it all up during the year, towards the end of the year, you run out of the money?
It would be for a period of time, so it wouldn't necessarily be for 1 year. You'd get fixed resource over a period of time, over 5 years, and you'd have that to 10 years. And you would be able to actually move that in terms of where do you have to invest it in order to save money later on, which is the service in the community setting. I think I'm not giving you a really full answer, because that is something that's still developing in how we're thinking about this, and we need to work through this with our partners in the provider sector as well about what does this actually mean for us.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to take Councillor Rennie and then Councillor Sullivan, please. Sorry, Chair, I'm repeating really what's been said, so I'll be very much on this, but I think what we are losing sight of, if you know, all ourselves here as councillors and clearly their own professions as well. I've actually noted that this is a public document. We are trying to do the best for the residents of Wirral, so we are basically providing the services for them. And I do have to say, there used to be a councillor on here, the former councillor Anne Bryson, and she used to harp on quite rightly, and this goes back over about 20 years, everything she quite rightly said should pass the failing vision test. Exactly what colleagues over there have said, I'd already drawn circles all around 3.2.4. We cannot talk in this sort of language when these are public documents. I mean, you know, in time gone by, you used to read a social, what was then the social services committee agenda. You'd read it once, you'd read it twice, the third time, you'd go, that's what they mean, it's quite simple. So if members of the public are picking this up and it's services for them, then clearly it's totally unacceptable for the reports to be presented in this manner. And I hope that we'll see an improvement next time. And perhaps, Chair, you may advise you into the recommendation.
Thank you. Okay, we have Councillor Sullivan, and then Councillor Lewis, and then Councillor Gordon, please.
Thanks, Chair. This whole agenda on item 6 makes me feel very uneasy. Some of the language that's used which people can understand, and I can certainly understand. Page 32, 311, the Wirral health and social care system is not sustainable in its current guise. I know. I'm only highlighting and as Sue over there said before, we want to get back to a people-centred NHS. I sit round here and I wonder what Nye Bevan, if he was sitting around this table now, would make of the discussions that we're having.
Councillor Sutherland, you have a question?
And it's a very important topic, Chair. No matter what the Chair thinks, or
when you say we're going back to people-centred care, the NHS has always been about people-centred care. I think I'm only deputising on this committee tonight, and some people might be glad of that. But I think we should, as a committee, we should keep an eye on this. We talk about procurement. This committee wants to know who the procurement vehicles are and the providers. This committee should be asking, who are those providers going to be? Is the money going to flow out of the NHS as it is at the moment into private hands and shareholders and not being used on the people who are ill and desperately needed? That's the assurances I would like. But it's been partly given by Sam.
And thank you, Chair. I'm sure Dr. Wiles would want to give a clinician's view on this, but the NHS was based upon a life expectancy of literally 3 score years in 10. So actuarial protection of people surviving into their late 60s, early 70s on average. And actually our life expectancy has increased. The amount of medicine and interventions can do to keep people living longer has increased. So we're in a very fundamentally different position now. As Dr. Wells said, it's about being policy implementers as well. And what we are trying to get to in a position is where we act as one, as a rural health and care economy, whether we are from a commissioning organisation or a provider organisation. Because it is only that way we can stop money flowing out of the NHS, as you put it. And being retained within our health economy and making sure that there is a strong place-based approach around rural. And place-based is about understanding what the populations need, getting ahead in terms of intervening, in terms of prevention and promotion of health, and making sure that, I mean, essentially vertical and horizontal integration, you can basically pull providers working better together and in partnership. Without all that sort of thing,
but do you want to add anything to that? No, I think, as I said before, this is about bringing us all together to do the best for the people we serve within the envelope that we are allocated. And so if I take this to the clinical world, to me as a GP, I see people on a regular basis who need some health care. They may need health care from myself, they may need assistance from district nurses, which is community trust, they may need mental health support, and they may well need social support. And I want those to work together for a person. So I believe in this because I believe it is the right thing to do for people. We also have to be pragmatic that there is a limited resource, and how do we get the best out of that? Can I also go back to a previous comment about jargon? I completely agree. We have to make sure that all our information is accessible, and I think that's one of our things of our organisations working closer together. Because somebody made a comment that maybe